Hello, this is Rabbi David Idenson, author of the book Secret of the Scale on Marriage and Human Relations. Our website is secretscale.com. Our topic today is a continuation of our previous videos, where we took the article of Thomas Friedman in the Times, where he quotes Mr. Samuelson of the Post, that there is an unmentionable problem in America, and that is the problem that children have apathy towards school and working. And if this is not solved, they said, what is there? And this, of course, leads to the terrible reality that people will only vote for politicians that are gimme-gimme politicians. In other words, I'm not going to sacrifice for the country. I'm not going to pay higher taxes, and I'm not going to do without various government programs. Gimme, gimme, and that's the end of America. So this is Mr. Samuelson's article quoted by Mr. Friedman, that the decline in America is rooted in the attitude of children who go to adulthood saying, gimme, gimme. And we discussed this. We discussed the role of television and training children to spend hours of gimme, gimme time, relax, let me have a good time. Matt is in the Haredi community where children are constantly pushed to achieve and learn. And I mentioned as I would, years ago, I was teaching kids who had been in school all day long till about 6 o'clock. And I, about 5:15, I gave them some work to do. And then it was recess, and they refused to go to recess because they enjoy working. A child is designed to grow, not to be entertained. And when we destroy a child by entertaining him, by teaching him to take the opium of life, pleasure, games, fun, we are not allowing the child to develop the skills to earn and be responsible. But there's a deeper idea here. And it's something that Mr. Samuelson and Mr. Friedman don't mention. They just touch on it. Yes, the children are pathetic, and yes, the children don't want to learn. But we have to go to the root of things. The root of things is like this. All of us as human beings, from the time we are formed in the embryo, and as we go through life, we are really on an assembly line. All human beings are on an assembly line. Maybe the whole biological system is on an assembly line, but human beings surely are an assembly line. And as they grow, every day that goes by, their processes affecting their entire system. Eventually, the processes will lead to aging, but as a person grows, the assembly line carries the person along who was a baby, then becomes a child, then becomes an adult. And there are constant windows opening up as we travel along the assembly line. There are constant windows opening. For instance, Henry Kissinger is a noted genius, but he can't speak English as well as, say, a four-year-old child, because he picked up English as a second language, and languages can only be truly assimilated in the system when a person is a child on the assembly line and the window goes open, the window opens and in comes a new language. Then the child assimilates it quickly. But if a person is a major genius and he doesn't have the age when the window was there, when he's on the assembly line, he's too old and he missed the boat, he'll never get it back. He'll never learn how to speak English the way a four-year-old can speak English. And all of us have these issues. If we miss out when we're young on nurture, we could go to therapists later and spend a fortune and try and read books. But if we didn't get it as a child, it's not natural, it's not real. And therefore, this is the key thing to keep in mind. There's an article, Why School Reform Fails, by Mr. Robert J. Samuelson, quoted by Thomas Friedman of the New York Times. Why it fails? Well, they have apathy, they're not interested. Yes, that's true, but why is it? And we said that these gentlemen left out the idea of television, but there's a deeper idea. Now we're talking about the biological process of life. where a child going on the assembly line, the child in my family, the Haredi family, the religious family oriented people, we don't have any televisions or anything like that. Let me tell you a story. I think I mentioned it once or twice before. When my daughter had a baby, so my daughters, they were little children, they were thrilled to babysit. So they sat in front of the house near the sidewalk with the baby. And a lady walks by, obviously not one of the religious people. And she glares at my daughters, little children, 5 years old. She glares at them. She says, "What are you doing?" And they said, "We're babysitting for our niece. Hint, hint, isn't he cute?" "My children aren't slaves." "Her children aren't slaves. My children are slaves. I'm a slave." If you're in a family-oriented situation, if you're in a social situation, if you live with other people, you're a slave to some degree. And when people don't want to be slaves, they have to go live in a cave by themselves, share it with the bats. That's life. Either you learn how to be a slave or you're lost. And today everybody is me. We're not slaves. Imagine babysitting for a little baby. Oh, watching television is acceptable. That's important. Going to the movies and playing video games. But babysitting for a nephew? That's slavery. And my daughters didn't burst out laughing at this lady. And they got into the house and then they burst out laughing. And that Passover, even though we don't have too much money here, I bought silver cups for the slaves. And that became a family joke, maybe the family joke, that we're slaves. And the fact is, you know what's true? My wife and I never had a vacation. I don't think my mother had a vacation. Does that mean that we're miserable? When you're doing things on the assembly line and you're going through life, and you're doing the things that nature requires you to do, which God requires you to do, which means to be a slave, to worry about other people, to be a slave to the assembly line of the process, to learn how to talk at the right age, not to wait for later, to learn what nurture and love means when you're young and you need it, and when you grow up, you learn to be yourself a loving, nurturing parent. But when we have a situation where the radical people came with Hollywood, with television, with Harvard and all, and Yale and all the modern people, let's come up with new ideas. They have tampered with the assembly line. They have tampered with nature. They have not allowed people, when they were children, to grow up with their nurture and the ideals that they need. And a child needs discipline. A child needs guidance. And instead of providing that, we have taught children, don't really bother to work. Don't let anybody tell you what to do. You are it. And the kids, well, they get into drugs and drink. And as Mr. Samuelson said, as Mr. Freeman quotes, there's an apathy there. There's apathy in the children. And why not? Because they missed the boat on the assembly line when they got from nature the nurture and the discipline and the drive to succeed and to be a slave. To be a slave means, if you want to be a doctor, you've got to be a slave. Heaven forfend any of us should go to a doctor that wasn't a slave. If a doctor isn't a slave, he murders people. How many hours does he have to spend on studying and understanding it? If you want to get somewhere in life, you've got to be a slave. You want to have a child. You like to wake up 3 o'clock in the morning because someone's crying. That's slavery. If you were making a living and there's not so much money and you have children, that's slavery. But we raise people to think, oh me, I've got to have fun. So you missed, there's no animal, there's no human that is designed by nature to have fun. Everyone has their set role in life and they have to go and work and develop. And we teach children to be unnatural, and not to be slaves, but to avoid work and avoid study, then they grow up the way they grow up today. And as Mr. Samuelson says, There are 56 million children that belong to the 133,000 elementary and secondary schools, and there is a tragedy because the school system is failing, and people are coming forward with all types of progressive ideas. Mr. Samuelson makes fun of them. He says all of this is not likely to work because all the things that people blame, that the teachers are at fault, or this one's at fault, not enough money, so that's ridiculous. We are raising children that don't want to learn, and as long as we have that, we will fail. And therefore, and this has happened recently as a result of my videos on television destroying children, etc. I've been in contact with people who have been kind enough to write to me or to contact me that they're not even Jewish, but they're scared for their children. They don't know how they can raise children in such a world. And that's exactly what the problem is. And I invite anyone who is interested in thinking how to deal with this. I'll tell you one thing. If you're alone with children, I don't think you have a big chance of succeeding. But there are people all around the world that I've spoken to, and I know they're out there, that really want to be in contact with like-minded people, not necessarily Jewish people. The group that I'm working with now is these are not Jewish people, and they're from different places in the world. Now, if anybody's interested, just today with the modern technology, with Skype, whatever, you can be in contact with people and have good conversations, and each person can encourage the other one. So if anyone is interested, they can contact me. These are YouTube videos, and there's ways of making comments and emails if you want to contact me. This is Rabbi David Eidenson, author of the book Secret of the Scale on Marriage and Human Relations. Our website is secretscale.com.